Welcome, welcome, welcome. Thank you for being here. I know a lot more people are going to be sliding in here, and we are very excited to see everybody here at this show. The entire experience team has been working very hard to make sure that everything is functioning and working, and please let us know if there's things we can do to help you as well. We're excited to see you, obviously, and we've worked hard on a great program. We're very excited about the program coming up next. So Jeff actually asked Barry and I to play, and we were like, holy crap, really? But we've had a good time.
It was fun. It was a lot of fun. Folks, the program you're going to be listening to right now is so necessary. If you were in Dr. Gavin McGregor Skinner's presentation, I said there were three things I wanted you to remember, and the first was simply two words, forensic cleaning. If we focus on forensic cleaning, aesthetically, it doesn't get better than that. But for so many years, and I've been in this industry over 50 years, we clean for aesthetics. We clean for what we see and what we don't see. But it's what we don't see. We just went through a pandemic, and our industry responded very poorly. If we had to give ourselves a report card, we did very, very poor during the pandemic. And it's only because we didn't have the knowledge we needed to do our work. Jeff Jones, I've been through his program, Microbial Warrior and High Risk, High Level Decontamination Specialist. I've completely relearned how to clean. And I thought I was pretty expert. I'm not that expert, but that man over there is. And I highly recommend you all really listen carefully, because if we do a better job in forensic cleaning, I think the health of our society is going to be a whole lot better place than it currently is right now.
So we have a cleaning contest going on also. I think we're up to about 15 contestants. We still have 5 positions left. And so I hope that you will register for that. You can do that online, or you can do that at the desk. They're happy to help you also. But there's this little prize of $2,200 ATP unit, a testing unit that will be given to one winner. So hope you will get involved. That's 5 o'clock on Thursday at the Floodhouse.
Yes.
Absolutely wonderful. So hope you're having an opportunity to not just join the education classes, but the trade show will open at 2:30 today. Hope you'll say thank you, especially to all of our sponsors. We really appreciate their help. They make this whole thing possible. Our exhibitors are wonderful. And at 6:30, hallelujah, somebody knew. We're having a fun party. So right at the back of the trade show hall at 6:30, if you'll just go to the back of the trade show hall, we'll open up the curtains. There's about a 20,000 square foot area back there, and you'll hear the music start playing right at 6:30. We have some ladies that are gonna blow you away playing their violins and cellos, and then Tanya Tucker's niece is gonna be there playing some country music for us. So we'll have 2 stages going on, a lot of other entertainment back there. We're really looking forward to it. Tons of food, bars set up, so we will have a great time back there. And I'm going to introduce our speaker now, and I usually just introduce Jeff, but I've learned that I should also introduce Lori. The two of these people are doing some fantastic work in our industry and changing the science, and that's really what our show has been about, is how do we raise the bar? How do we look for the science? How do we challenge what we're currently doing and look for new and better ways and real science that works for cleaning, restoration, and of course, the forensic cleaning world that Jeff lives in. Jeff is a certified bioforensic restoration specialist, certified forensic operator. He says he's got 50 years experience. He started when he was 4 and a half, but that's probably true, knowing his dad, Joe, so that probably did happen. He is a former U.S. Army soldier, former SWAT team leader, youngest person to attend the FBI Academy in Virginia, Jeff is a certified crime scene track investigator, as well as a certified search and rescue tracker. He's the past president of the RIA, was the chairman of the Forensic Council, and is the co-editor of RIA Forensic Guidelines, as well as a contributor to the ANSI IICRC S540 standard for trauma and crime scene cleanup. Jeff Jones is one of the founding members of BioSheen Services, is the director of forensic operations, master trainer for the Global BioRisk Advisory Council, and is considered by many the most experienced forensic restoration field operator in the world. We are truly blessed to have this level of knowledge, like many of our other presenters, come to the experience and share their knowledge and experience. Please help me welcome to the stage Jeff Jones, and I think Lori might be joining him.
Would you please rise and join me in the Pledge of Allegiance. I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the Republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all. Thank you. Lord, grant us keen eyes, steady hands, and servants' hearts, that we may be a blessing to those in need. In Jesus' holy name, amen. Thank you, Ben. Okay. Traditional Navajo believe that for a person to live a long and healthy and happy life, it's essential to live in balance, physically, mentally, and spiritually. The Navajo word for that balance is hozo, H-O-H-Z-O. When one of those elements are out of balance, physically, mentally, or spiritually, the doors to sickness and death open up. As a matter of fact, a lot of traditional Navajo healing ceremonies are simply ceremonies to restore that hozo, that balance in people's lives. Now, I know there are people out here that have never done a forensic restoration job, but you've done fire, you've done water, okay, you're cleaners. Let me tell you something. Anytime somebody calls you, it's because the hozo in their life has been disturbed. And in my case, quite often, that hozo has been disturbed violently. Seems like the whole world's out of balance right now, doesn't it? Okay? There's no hozo. One thing that I learned as a young man working as a lifeguard, one of the most dangerous things that you can do is to try to save a drowning person, because if you're not a strong swimmer, they'll pull you down with them. Okay, so if you're not in hozo when that phone rings, you're going to be of no use to your company, your team, or that precious client. So what I want to do right now, this is my sister Rose Blue Eyes from the Navajo Indian Reservation. Rose is an award-winning master weaver. And I'm going to ask Rose to say a blessing for each and every one of you to start right here and right now, grounding you in that hozo. So you're not just better workers, but you're better human beings and we're better servers. Okay, because we're not crime scene cleaners. I hate that term. Okay, we're not water restoration specialists. We're not fire and smoke restoration specialists. When you really boil it down, what we are, we're the caretakers of the human condition. And handle it carefully, my friends, for it is fragile. Rose?
Okay. Hello. My name is Rose Blue Eyes. I'm from the Napo Reservation, a place called Sinasi, New Mexico, up in there. Lived there all my life. My parents were Wolford and Margaret Lewis, and I had a sibling of six brothers, and I'm only sister. So I'm really glad that I'm here and that my brother Jeff invited me to come along and do this prayer for you guys. So I'm really happy to do that, and I'm happy to be here. So let's bow our heads. In Jesus' name I pray, amen.
Thank you.
Love you, brother.
Love you. Ayo, anina shne. Hey, Lori. I'm on that. I'm on. You can come up. They know who you are. They know you're the real brains behind this thing.
You click it forward, it'll play.
The country's fentanyl crisis, specifically in American teens, hundreds have already died from drug overdoses.
A powerful painkiller known as fentanyl is responsible for one of the deadliest drug crises in the United States.
Marijuana being mixed with fentanyl.
Traffickers adding fentanyl to everything.
Fentanyl with that being called a nationwide disaster.
What's the prime directive?
Safety.
Here's the danger. That's a number two pencil. That's the dose of fentanyl that will kill you graveyard death.
Based on the sciences of virus management and infection control, Microbial Warrior is a tactical system of strategy for forensic restoration.
What are our four objectives? Whether it's fentanyl, carfentanyl, opioids, xylanine, this is weaponized anthrax.
Contain, control, neutralize, remove.
Start the decontamination process on the lower horizontal surface. You'll be entering in pairs. As a team, we're going to make a tactical incursion. That's a mindset. Tactical means that we have a plan. Incursion means that we're going to attack this contaminant. And this is a dry fire exercise. The lead person will have the induction charge electrostatic delivery system with our decontamination agent in it. As he enters and begins the delivery process, the second person lay down a cone, and as I'm moving forward, is going to mark my areas. So when you actually get the delivery system in your hands, you'll be able to see the width of the spray.
We're going to use what's called a basket weave pattern. We're going to do horizontals, and then we're going to follow up with verticals.
Thank you. day, you know, let's face it, safety is paramount for myself, my employees, anybody who's going to walk into a hazardous, potentially life-threatening hazardous situation.
The hands-on part is the invaluable piece to this. Just suiting up, I mean, you could watch a video of a guy spraying the carpet, but until you're doing it, learning the techniques, and Jeff stands there and watches what's going on. Mm-hmm. And he'll grab the instrument from you and says, no, this way. Yeah. Then he puts it right back in your hand and then you do it. I think that's a very critical piece.
Amateurs train till they get it right. Professionals train till they cannot get it wrong. There's not a contaminant or a pathogen on this planet I can't negotiate.
Pound gorilla in the room, the most dangerous contaminant of my life, and I've been in this industry for over 53 years. Okay, the current occupant of 1600 Pennsylvania Avenue, the White House, I chose those words carefully. Okay, he has declared that a national emergency, but actually, that's a global emergency. And what you see at the head of that number two pencil is enough to kill you graveyard dead. Okay. Real quick story, because this has not been released, but you're going to hear it right here, okay, because this is going to litigation. But a biohazard company was dispatched to a loss of life incident site where that individual had lost his life due to a drug overdose. So what this biohazard cleanup company did was just clean up the bodily fluids, spiffed and sprayed their disinfectant, and left. So then the property owner hires some general cleaning service to come in and start prepping the rest of the property out. Well, one of them fell over dead. And so the rest of the crew pulled out, and the police came in. They're like, there's something going on here. Well, it tested positive for fentanyl. Okay, so now the family of the deceased is suing the biohazard company, saying you didn't do your job completely. And the biohazard company's response is, we were going off what we knew. Okay? So who's right and who's wrong? Okay. Here's the problem with the biohazard cleanup company. They failed to acquire all of their critical incident data, which is who, what, where, when, how. Okay? If somebody tells me that someone died of a drug overdose, what's the 800-pound gorilla in the room? It's fentanyl. So you always assume the worst on a situation. And then if it's not, everything's going to be okay. But if I tell you tomorrow, I'm like, hey, we're going to go hunting. You ready? We're going to leave at 4 a.m. Okay? And then you show up with a .22 rifle, and I said, oh, I didn't tell you we were hunting grizzly bears? Okay? You're not suited and you're not ready. Okay? Nobody's ready until you've gone through training for this. Training is so important. Okay? Then we've got microbial threats. Infectious disease are a global hazard. Infectious diseases have killed more people than all the wars in history combined. Every day, over 1,300 new pathogens are introduced into our environment. And every 20 minutes, a new generation of microbes are spawned, and they have memories. So the people that go out and do this spray and pray nonsense and didn't kill those, they survive. They pass on that memory to the next generation. They say, oh, beware of this. So they become stronger. Okay. We didn't have super bugs when I was a kid. We do now because they become resistant. Listen, Mother Nature finds a way. And I don't know how to break this to you, but Mother Nature is a serial killer. And that heifer is crazy. She is always constantly plotting our demise. These are our natural microbial threats, okay? Let me start at the bottom. It's an enveloped virus. An enveloped virus, this is the easiest one. You can't kill it. Why can't you kill it? Because it's not a living organism. It's like a zombie. You can inactivate it, but you cannot kill a virus. I know what Lysol says, kills 99.9% of bacteria, germs, and viruses. You cannot, false advertising already. You cannot kill that which is not alive, but you can inactivate it. Look at those two at the bottom. Those should be the easiest, but those are the two that, remember years ago when everybody was scared of Ebola? Okay, and now COVID, okay? COVID should be the easiest one, but it's not. COVID, the coronavirus that causes COVID-19, and let's be frank on this. Coronaviruses come from mammals. Influenza comes from birds. But if you believe that we got this coronavirus from some guy eating a bat in a wet market, you know, I've got oceanfront property to sell you in Arizona. That did not happen, okay? That's another discussion, and don't get me going on that. But a coronavirus, what is a common cold? It's a coronavirus, okay? Have they ever found a cure for the common cold? No. Guys like Mr. Pettyjohn and I that are long in the tooth, we can remember like commercials like, they can put a man on the moon, but they can't cure the common cold, okay? They'll never cure it, and they're never gonna cure this coronavirus. But let me tell you the good news on this, because I've lost, don't think I take this lightly, I've lost three members of my family from that, okay? But each and every one of them had a comorbidity, okay? My Navajo sister Rose, she lost her mother. She lost her mother and her father. She lost her mother, her father, and her husband. So we don't take this lightly. But what should have been one of the easiest ones to negotiate as an industry, we failed. And we failed miserably. Okay? Next up is gram positive. There's a great example of it right there. MRSA, then gram negative. These are bacterias. These we can kill. A great example of gram negative is E. coli. Those are bacterias. And then fungi like Candida auris, which is one of the tougher molds and fungi to negotiate. And then non-enveloped viruses. A great example of that are neuroviruses, which you hear about outbreaks on the cruise ships. Okay, that's when everybody gets it coming out of both ends. They're really nasty things, but neuroviruses can live on surfaces for months. Okay, they're very hardy. They're non-enveloped. You would think that the enveloped would be the hardy one. No, you just pop that. It's made out of proteins. You can pop it with soap and water on the ones down at the bottom and negotiate those. These are hardier, and they're getting stronger all the time. And so when something lives on a surface and you're able to get infected from that, the name of that, whether it's this chair or this right here or a doorknob, that becomes a fomite. I mean, it's a contaminated surface and it has an infectious agent on it. Fomite is spelled F-O-M-I-T-E, fomite. You start using these words in your vocabulary. Because I've had people come up to me and they're like, hey, how much can I get if I do that? How much? You're not going to get anything if you can't conduct yourself as a professional. Dress like a professional, talk like a professional, and work like a professional. Then I'll guarantee you're going to make professional wages. Okay. The next up from that is mycobacteria like tuberculosis. Tuberculosis really is what sets the bar in a professional disinfectant. What I look for in a real disinfectant is an EPA registered hospital grade tuberculosidal disinfectant with a 6-log kill, proven to kill both gram negative, gram positive bacteria and activate both enveloped and non-enveloped virus. Notice when I said a 6-log kill, okay? Lysol, I'm gonna explain log kills really quick and then you'll leave this room, you'll be smarter than anybody here. Lysol says it kills 99.9. That's its log kill. There are three nines, okay? Here's how you understand that. Take the three nines, turn them into zeros and put a one in front of them, okay? So what have you got, 1,000, right? That means if you take 1,000 particles, and let's just use COVID for a second. I take 1,000 particles of COVID and I put them on a Petri dish, and I spray that and I let it have the manufacturer's recommended dwell time. At the end of that dwell time, out of 1,000, one will live. That's a 3-log kill, okay? So I said I look for a 6-log kill. That's 99.9999. Take the nines, turn them into zeros, put a one in front. What have you got? 1,000,000. So now let's take a million particles of our contaminant, put them on a petri dish, spray them, allow the dwell time. Now, out of a million, how many will survive?
One.
That's right. One. Okay? So I know there are people out there that are thinking, well, then the only absolute is sterilization. That's wrong. Sterilization is a 12-log kill. You're like, holy moly, are there any absolutes? I'm like, yes, there are. Death, taxes, and mean people suck. Okay? Those are your only absolutes in this life. Then we get into bacterial spores. This is something bacterial spores like C. diff. Each year, around 20,000 Americans die from C. diff. These spores, C. diff itself is a gram-positive bacteria. It lies within the intestinal section, and people that get that usually get very violent diarrhea, and they dehydrate themselves to death. All of this EPA-registered hospital-grade tuberculocidal disinfectant with a 6-log kill won't even phase those bacterial spores. You've got to have a sporicide. So if you get called for a C. diff job, I want you to understand C. diff can live on a surface for 7 to 9 months. It's extremely hardy. All these other disinfectants, unless it's on the label, they're not going to work on it. I mean, we have equipment and gears, Lori and I do, that specifically for when we get a C. diff job. And I'm actually going to show you one here in a little bit. Here we go. Easiest to kill. Enveloped viruses. Bacteria. Fungi. Non-enveloped viruses, mycobacterium like tuberculosis, and then bacterial spores. So if I've got something that will handle bacterial spores and mycobacterium, you can bet I can handle the rest of them. That's why I want something with a 6-log kill that's a proven tuberculocidal disinfectant. If something has, somebody says, hey, I've got this wonderful disinfectant for you that's got a 4-log kill, that's not a disinfectant. That's a sanitizer. Okay, sanitizing reduces contaminants to an acceptable level, but that could be extremely subjective because what's an acceptable level on a hog farm is not the same acceptable level in a neonatal care facility. Traditional forensic restoration projects on top of what we already just looked at and talked about. This is our bread and butter every day. Homicide, suicide, accidental, and natural deaths. Those are the, in the world of forensics, those are the four types of deaths. So when you get a phone call and you get a loss of life incident, it's either going to be homicide, suicide, accidental, or a natural death. Any one of those can become an unattended death. Human decomposition begins approximately 4 minutes after death. And the variables in that are temperature and relative humidity, in that order. Someone that has passed away is going to decomp different in Phoenix, Arizona than they are in New Orleans. Okay, and an average body, there's 1.2 to 1.5 gallons of blood. In an average human body that's 200 pounds, 120 pounds of that are bodily fluids. They're all going to go someplace. And so the longer that deceased is there, the bigger your scene is going to be to negotiate that and bring that into a healthy, happy, hygienic environment. One of the things that we want to look at, this is microbial work. This is a whole system. This is how we do this. Based on the sciences of biorisk management and infection control, microbial warrior is a tactical system of strategy for forensic restoration and decontamination. If I were building a house, and I want to start this out proper, if I were building a house, the first thing that I want to do is lay a solid foundation. Honor is a word that men have fought and died for hundreds of years. Okay? In my life, I have taken 3 vows, and they were all based on honor. The first one I took as a boy, and it said, on my honor, I will do my duty to God and my country to be square and obey the law of the pact. That was my Cub Scout oath, okay? The next one I took a vow to defend the U.S. Constitution from all enemies, both foreign and domestic. And the next vow I took on my honor was when I stood in Santa Fe, New Mexico, and promised to love, cherish, and did I say obey? No, I didn't. No, no. I was hungover. Okay? No. In 1966, my father started a part-time cleaning company, okay? In 1969, he went full-time with that. That same year, he got a call from a guy in his Sunday school class whose son had made the unfortunate decision to take his own life with a firearm. All this guy knew was my dad knew how to clean things. There wasn't such thing as like a crime scene cleaner. That's a made-up Hollywood term that came about in the late 90s with Samuel L. Jackson's The Cleaner and that other movie, Sunshine Cleaning Company. All my father knew was somebody was hurting and he could go and help them. That's what opened up the door for that right there. In 1972, when I was 12 years old, my dad got a call on a self-cessation. That's a term that we use professionally because I don't say suicide. Even though I listed the four types of death, homicide, suicide, accidental, and natural, when I'm dealing with a family that's gone through that, I never use that word suicide. I use the term self-cessation. So it could be self-cessation via firearm, self-cessation via laceration, self-cessation during an overdose or alcohol, self-cessation during asphyxiation. They hung themselves. And here's why. Because I never know exactly who I'm going to be dealing with. And some cultures and some religions have a stigma about suicide. Some believe, like people with the Church of Rome, that if you take your own life, you can't go to heaven. Partner, that's way above my pay grade. Okay, I don't make those decisions. I'm there to help people. So that's why we use the term self-cessation. So I went with my father. I had to beg him that Saturday morning to let me go and help him with this self-cessation via firearm. And here's why I got to go. One, my father had already seen this incident site. And if I was going to break anybody in today that was green, it would have been perfect. It was small caliber. There was not a large debris field. Two, here's the second reason I got to go. I spent my summers on a farm in Tennessee, and I understood the cycle of life. So if we're going to have chicken on Sunday, you got to catch them on Saturday. Okay? We processed hogs. We milked cows. I understood all that. But the big reason I got to go that day as 12 years old with my dad after much begging and pleading was my mom was out of town, okay? And my dad said, if you tell your mom, I swear I will wear your butt out. He, man, it's 1972. You could legally do that, okay? Corporal punishment wasn't judged. It was graded. My dad got an A. Many years later, in the 80s, I went and did a job with my father. It was an unattended death. It was August. It was summertime. This gentleman had taken his life with a shotgun in the bathtub, and they had left a window cracked, so a lot of vectors, flies got in. It was really bad. And we went out and remediated together because he sent me out first. He said, go set ozone, go and do a pre-spray of a disinfectant. And what was everybody using back then? It was Microban. Go spray some Microban and stuff. And I came back. He said, how bad is it? I said, it's the worst thing I've ever seen. And he said, well, I don't want to do that to any of our team. Do you think you and I can handle it? And I said, absolutely we can. So we started early that morning and we negotiated that scene. And then we came back shortly before closing that day. And you know what? We didn't say a word to each other on the way back. We didn't say anything when we got to the shop. We just got out. Both of us knew we had things to do. But the next morning, Dad and I were always the first ones there. He came in and I had coffee going. He didn't even say good morning that morning. He got his coffee and he sipped it for a second. He said, I don't want to do that anymore. I said, you don't want to do what anymore? He said, I don't want to do any more death scene cleanup. And I went, why not? He goes, son, I took two showers when I got home last night. He said, that's the last thing I thought about before I went to sleep. And it's the first thing I thought about when I got up this morning. Do you not have any idea how smart that was? I mean, we couldn't even spell PTSD back then. But what he was doing was safeguarding himself. Because if this is a path that you want to go down, I mean, the world needs you. They do. Okay? But I want you to understand that each and every one of us, moi included, have a saturation point. And once you reach that, you're done. Okay, that's it. Like a cash register can only hold so much money, and that's it. Then you're done. I've got one. I hope I never get there, to tell you the truth, because my whole life is one in pursuit of honor as a samurai. And I don't mean a Japanese warrior. Do you know what that word actually means? The word samurai, when translated into English, means one who serves. That's my whole deal. That's why I do what I do. Okay, what's one of the great commandments? Jesus said, take care of my sheep. I'm a sheepdog. Okay, I need more sheepdog. Okay, because there's a lot of wolves out there. So when my father said, I don't want to do anymore, I said, well, Dad, I do. I said, you know, I think it's a very valuable and viable service that we offered. And he said, well, you're good at it. One of the few times I got a compliment from him. And he said, who knows? Maybe one day you'll take it to a different level. But son, all I've got to say is this. The day you're not going to treat that as a ministry, close the doors, go do something else. And that's exactly what we do today. This is a ministry based on biorisk management and infection control. You see this? This is a bone scraper, okay? Guys from the old school know exactly what it is. You use this to work off crusties and heavy contaminants off fine fabrics. You know what it is, okay? My father carried this from 1968 to the day he died, and now it is mine. And so on the name that my mother and father gave me and on my honor, I promise you every word you're going to hear from me is true. Let's train. Okay? I'm big on training. Bruce Lee said, I don't worry about the guy that knows 10,000 techniques. I worry about the guy that trains one technique 10,000 times. Training should be mentally, physically, and spiritual. But unfortunately, all we can really do today is mental training. But let's train. Okay? Real training, mind, body, and spirit. Okay? Today's training objectives are identify the prime directive, identify three major attributes of a microbial warrior. Identify the three major concerns of any forensic restoration project. And identify the four tactical steps, which we affectionately call the four T's. Okay? The prime directive is safety. You know, when I was a kid, you know, when I got out of school, I would run home before I threw my afternoon paper route because Star Trek was going to be on. The real one with the real James T. Kirk, who dated green women and kicked butt, okay? But there was a prime directive that the Federation had. You could not, should not, will not alter any pre-existing civilization. The prime directive in forensic restoration is safety. Cannot, shall not, will not be violated. The newest member of my team can call a halt to all operations if he sees something that could be a safety hazard. The four T's are, and these are on every project, okay? Training, tactics, techniques, and tools. Training, you have got to have it. And I don't mean going to somebody's class and sitting for 15 hours watching a bunch of PowerPoints. You got to suit up. If you want to box, you got to glove up and get in the ring. You want to swim, you got to suit up and jump in the water. You got to find a training program that'll get you as close as you can to real-world combat situations. The attributes of a microbial warrior. Attributes are things that lie within you. Care, compassion, and concern. Because I don't care if you've had the best training. I don't care if you've got the coolest sprayer and the baddest respirator and all these cool tools and your truck looks great. If you don't have care, compassion, and concern for your fellow man, you're in the wrong industry, amigo. Three major concerns of any project are going to be structure, contents, and indoor air quality, and not necessarily in that order. So the greater the magnitude, the more you've got to look at that. How are we going to do the structure? What contents can we save? What is cleanable? And indoor air quality, how are we going to handle that? The four tactical steps of any project, whether it's a homicide, suicide, accidental, natural death, or whether it's a case of fentanyl, or whether it's biological WMDs, and I'm telling you right now, I was a counterterrorist specialist in the military. There are bad people out there plotting bad things right now as we speak, okay? And it's coming, okay? They've had ISIS guys coming across our southern border already, and it's not coming here to picnic. These guys are religious zealots, and they firmly believe they're going to heaven if they kill as many of us as they can. And they've watched the Chinese. They watch the response to this virus. You wreck a country, you shut their economic system down, that's good. You kill as many men, women, and children as you can, that's good. Don't ever forget 9/11. But regardless of the project and its magnitude, we want to contain, control, neutralize, and remove. Okay, did I learn that in somebody's class? No. This was basic SWAT strategy when I worked SWAT. We want to contain, control, neutralize, and remove. The guys down in Uvalde, Texas, evidently they never learned this. But if you watch the active shooter in Nashville, Tennessee, they had this down. Problem solved in 14 minutes. Everything begins with a phone call. Does it? Does it? I've had some people that came and copied one of my presentations and stuff, and they said everything begins with a phone call. No, it does not. Everything begins with a conscious decision on your part that this is something that you want to do. This is something that you want to make the world a better place, that you want to live a life of service, that you want to become a microbial warrior. When you're taking a phone call, when that phone rings, you need to have that training. You need to have that gear. And let me give you a word of advice. When that phone rings, I know a guy named Peter Massey that runs a rug washing facility in Santa Rosa, California. He's a great guy. If we called him right now on the phone, somebody would pick up the phone and go, "Hey, it's a wonderful day at Master Clean." Let me tell you something. The people that are making that call to you are not having a wonderful day. So my wife will tell you and my team that, like, when I answer the phone, I kind of drop my voice down an octave. It sounds like I'm an FM DJ. And I'm like, "Biosheen Services, this is Jeff. How can I be of service?" You know. And then there's critical incident data that we have to acquire. I actually heard a guy one time in a presentation, "Don't ever say you're sorry, because, you know, that lady I had it where," she said, "Well, I'm not sorry he's dead. That son of a bitch abused me." And I'm like, now, how often does that happen? Really, don't ever be afraid to tell another human being that you're sorry. I even tell people, "I'm sorry that you even had to make this call." Now, for us to do our job in a professional manner, I'm going to need to acquire some information. Are you the right person that I should be talking to? Are you okay right now? And sometimes they pass the phone off, and then sometimes they'll say, "Yes, I can do this." Okay, but you need to let them know you're going to ask some delicate questions. Who are you talking to? What is their relationship to this incident side? Are they family? Are they friends? Are they a property owner? Are they a government official? What has happened? Is this a loss of life incident, like homicide, suicide, accidental or natural death? Is this an unattended death? Is this contamination from an infectious agent? What has happened? Where did it happen? Someone that died and was there for 3 days on ground floor is different than somebody that died on the second floor and bled out. How much blood is in the average human body? Between 1.2 and 1.5 gallons of blood. Way to go. Okay, and how in an average 200-pound body, how many pounds of bodily fluids are there? Exactly right. Over 120 pounds of bodily fluids. They're going to go somewhere. So if they're on the second floor of a condo unit or an apartment, all that's going to go somewhere. It's going to mitigate, and you're going to end up doing some major, what I call, controlled demolition. Because you're not going to go in there and spray and mop and do all that. That's nonsense. That's not forensic restoration. When did it happen? Was it, sometimes you'll get a call, they're still waiting for the police to release the scene. Sometimes, and we just finished one. The gentleman passed away. It was a natural death. He weighed over 300 pounds. He died on his futon, but he was there for 3 months before anybody found him, okay? Then once the body or what was left of it was taken out, then they waited another 3 months to call us because he gave his property to a foundation. And then they got our name and number, and then we went to work from there. Do you think that was like a large loss incident site? Yes, it was. And then how did it happen? Decision time. This is before you ever get in the truck. What biorisk are we going to put this at? What PPE levels? And we're going off the critical incident data that we obtained on the phone. How many people, show of hands, group participation exercise, do water restoration in this class? Okay. How many times have you heard them say, well, it's only wet over there. It's only wet over there because that's where they walked. Okay. You get out there and it's a whole house. I mean, I grew up doing this. Okay. So you're acquiring this, but you've got to be ready to be fluid. Okay. General George S. Patton said, combat is fluid. Okay. This is exactly what this is. This is microbial warfare. And so what are our PPE levels going to be? What are our delivery systems? What products are we going to need? What tools? And how are we going to handle waste management? I'm sorry, man. I didn't mean to bore you. I'm playing. Right here. Here's your seven-step method right here. Okay? I don't even mind if you take a photo of that. You need an incident site risk assessment to determine your scope of work, pre-testing, preconditioning, load reduction, forensic restoration, post-testing, and final disinfecting. That if you'll follow those seven steps right there and you understand each one of them, there's really nothing that you can't negotiate with proper training. For what was first up when we get there? It's a site assessment to determine the scope of forensic restoration, to identify safety concerns, the prime directive, to determine the operation zone, the transition zone, and the clear zone, to take initial ATP scores when applicable. And I'm going to talk about that. To take measurements and to take photos, because you're going to need all of that data if you're dealing with an adjuster. And especially when everything is done, you need to document everything for your invoice, because these are not small invoices that are done properly. Okay, but you've got to be able to back that up. And if it's not written down, if it's not in the paperwork, it didn't happen. You can't go back later and say, oh yeah, but we did this. No, doesn't exist. Variable on this. Here are variables when you're starting to figure this out. Cross-contamination, that's not water. Those are bodily fluids from first responders, okay? That's them going in and out. So we showed up at this unattended death site, and somebody asked, you want us to show you where the body was? I was like, you know, at this point, I think Stevie Wonder could find it, you know? So that's, first responders, and they're going to cross-contaminate things. That's just all there is to that. Transfer from my boot or your shoes happens for a minimum of 29 steps. How do I know this? Because I'm a certified tracker, and I'm a certified crime scene track investigator. 29 steps. The average human stride is 2.5 feet. You figure that out really quick. That is 72. Feet. So the scope of your work is not just there, it's a circle around 72.5 feet. In fact, if you read Dr. Michael Berry's book, he'll tell you everything has got to be cleaned and disinfected in the event of an unattended death. Now, this is a self-cessation via firearm right here. Okay, so that's the immediate scene right there. Here's the cross-contamination from Bob's Bad Body Handling Service. Okay. That's them wheeling the deceased out. So now they've just expanded the project. And here, they couldn't even make the turn properly. That's the same deal. So that's cross-contamination. Here's cross-biocontamination. What you see those dots are right there? Those are flies. Okay? The guy's brother decided that if he put, like, that wasn't enough to keep people out, so he put up this COVID sign. You know, so we pulled up there, and here's the deal. I mean, you can go take somebody's class all you want to, but why don't you ask them, when's the last time you actually did a job and were in the field? Because most of them, it hadn't been since the Nixon administration, okay? But we pulled up to this one. See all those? Like, they're even on the air conditioner unit right there. Those are all flies. Those are vectors. They carry and transfer bacteria everywhere. Look at that. I stepped into the room and I saw that and I was like, Lord, don't move real sudden, but please get me a shot of this. okay? Those transfer bacteria everywhere, and they turn those surfaces into what? Fomites. Okay, so everything's got to be cleaned and disinfected. And that's where he went to liquid, right there. Okay, pre-testing. This is an actual job. That's Lori's hand right there. We're going to do our pre-testing with an adenosine triphosphate meter. What does that measure? RLUs, relative light units, that are in every living organism. Will they measure viruses? No. No. Because they're not living organisms, but they will bacteria. And bacteria continues to multiply. Viruses need a host. Bacteria can create its own food source. So this is an actual job. That's incredibly high. 9,339. That was a knife attack right there. And this is after we've cleaned it. Now we've got that down to a 6. Do you think there's any difference there? I want single digits. Preferably zeros, but concrete is extremely hard to negotiate because it's so porous. We got that down to a 6. Now we can disinfect it. You cannot disinfect a dirty or contaminated surface. It's got to be cleaned first. So, but we will precondition that with an EPA registered product. One of the things that we need to look at, what's our delivery system? I don't like pump sprayers because they can send things airborne. Don't use ULVs on preconditioning because, again, that can send things airborne, especially fentanyl, both of those. I like electrostatics, but not all that crap that people were selling during COVID, okay? Because most of them weren't. How do I know? Lori and I have been to a facility where every one of those sprayers were tested, and almost none of them could deliver electrostatic capabilities, except a couple, okay? What you look for is an induction charge, rather than a contact charge. An induction charge is 10 times higher than a contact charge is, okay? Load reduction. The load reduction is defined as the removal of all gross amounts, no pun intended, okay, of biological contaminants and placed for proper disposal. Now we're ready for forensic cleaning. Cleaning is defined as the removal of soil, both visible and invisible. Forensic cleaning is defined as the removal of biological and pathogenic contaminants to prepare surfaces, both vertical and horizontal, for professional disinfecting. Dry cleaning prepares surfaces for wet cleaning. See that? This is on an actual job. We dry clean the wall first. Look how much dirt we got off of that. That's just one wall. Anybody that's done oriental rugs or carpets will tell you, you want to get rid of the dry soil first rather than creating a mud bath for anything. One time I was in the back at our cleaning facility and we threw down a 9x12 Karistan Kerman rug and it just looked like a mushroom cloud went off. So we started dusting it and I would sweep it up and I threw it in the trash and all of a sudden, bing, light bulb, okay? So I started putting that dirt into a bucket and my dad came back and he goes, "Are you guys still working on that one rug?" I said, "Dad, it's filthy. It's like they had a rodeo on it." And he's like, "What are you doing there?" I said, "I'm putting all the dirt in this bucket." And he goes, "Why?" I said, "Because I want to weigh it, okay, and see what I got out of a 9x12 Karistan." He goes, "Oh, okay." So when we had finally finished our dusting, I swept all that up. I put it on the scales. I would love to tell you that I got 60 pounds of dirt out of a 9x12 Karistan. I can't. Okay, I'd already thrown a bunch away, but I got 54 pounds of dirt out of a Karistan rug. So that right there shows the importance of that. Then we go to wet cleaning, and I like to wet clean with a foaming agent that I can get it to adhere to surfaces, and I get really good contact time. Contact time's important, okay? Here's an example of, look up, that's nicotine, look down, and you'll start to see a difference in the cleaning. That right there has not been repainted. That's a stairwell on an unattended death, unsanitary dwelling, and I cleaned that. What I'm doing is I'm shooting ahead of my team. I don't micromanage people. So what I'm doing, I'll shoot ahead and I'll clean an area and they know. Just match that, okay? Match what Jeff did. That's a windowsill right there. It hasn't been repainted. It's just been Part of it's clean, part of it's not clean. I'll let you guess which part. Okay, microwave oven. Cleaning is the heart and soul, not spraying God knows what, like a lot of people did during COVID, making outlandish promises. You've got to clean it first. Boom, she's got a zero on there. That's really out in the field right there. What's my time? Because I want to hit. It's 2 o'clock. And what time is this over with? Okay, that's why she's my boss. Okay, good. I just have to move through it. I never get finished with one of these things. I never have. Disinfecting, professional disinfecting runs in three equal parts. There's the disinfectant, the bug juice, let's call it that. And that is an EPA registered hospital grade tuberculocidal disinfectant with a 6-log kill, proven to kill both gram negative, gram positive bacteria and inactivate both enveloped and non-enveloped viruses. But then there's the delivery system. How are we going to apply that? I told you I like induction charged electrostatic delivery systems. I've got a Tomy SteraMist too. I mean, that's not a cheap unit, but when we use it, deploy it, it's great what it was made for. Okay, it's not the end all to end alls. And then there's the operator. Listen, if you have the best bug juice and you've got this awesome delivery system, but the guy behind it the week before was asking, you want fries with that? The whole thing is out of balance. There's no harmonics there. That's where training comes in, okay? Each delivery system has a recommended distance that you should be for maximum professional application. And when we train people, we measure that out and show them, I don't want the tip of that delivery system, that sprayer, I don't want it to cross that barrier. You do it from this distance. And we do it over and over again until people start to get it right. Waste management, listen, there's no federal law on that. In fact, that can go from jurisdiction to jurisdiction. What one county says, another county wants something else done with it. So you always have to check with that. You're always going to have to dispose of this as medical waste. Considerations again, all the knowledge, skill sets, and tools and training on this planet are nothing without care, compassion, and concern for your fellow human being. So I've said, what biorisk level are you going to put that in? So there are 5 biorisk levels. We're going to look at them really quick. Okay. Biorisk level 1 is the emission of any bodily fluid. Okay. It could be from trauma. It could be somebody threw up. Okay. Don't take that lightly, because I know a team that contracted tuberculosis from vomit. Okay. Walgreens will pay people to go and pick up a used feminine napkin in the bathroom because their people are not, they won't let their people do that. Okay. This one, and I know you guys that clean carpet. I mean, I grew up cleaning carpet too. Would go, why didn't you knife it out? I said, cause she wouldn't let me. That's why. I told her this is going to come back, you know? And she said, well, I said, listen, it's down. It's penetrated primary backing. It's in the pad. It's probably on the subfloor. She said, it's my carpet. It's my blood. You're not cutting it out. It's only 30 days old. And it, finally, I mean, we were going back and forth on this, and then she finally hit me. She goes, if you're not going to do it, if you're not going to clean it, I'm going to call Stanley Steamer. I was like, you know how there's the external you, and then there's the internal you? Because my internal you went, oh, you did not just say that to me. Okay. So I said, okay, it's going to come back. You know, she said, will you come back? I said, yes, I will, but I'm going to charge you for it. I don't care. She had money. Okay, so she called me the next day and she goes, it came back. I went, no. Will you come back today? I'm like, no. I want it to cure. It's called a capillary wicking action. And so finally, Laura and I, we finished it out. Boom, there it is. Biorisk level 2, this is where crime, trauma, and death scenes start to come into play. Okay, but on this one, on biorisk level 2, you do not alter the structure. If you have to even pull up carpet and pad, you moved into biorisk level 3. Okay, biorisk level 2 is straight forensic testing, forensic cleaning, and then professional disinfecting, but we do not alter the structure at BioRisk Level 2. This was a guy that, he was a deacon in his church, pillar of the community. Everybody thought well of him, a successful executive. Problem, he was molesting his 12-year-old daughter, okay? So once that was found out, he took his own life. And there that was right there, and we were able to negotiate that. I also mentioned on there hoarding bats, bird nests, and rodents. Those are some of the things that you could come across. Okay, BioRisk Level 3, we've got to alter the structure. This was 17-year-old. We saw more teenagers take their lives during COVID right there. And this was the week before Christmas in his mother and father's master closet right there. Okay, just a fine, wonderful, beautiful family. It was an honor to serve them. And we mourn each and every loss right with them because we're human beings. Okay. I'll tell you this straight up. I am not a robot and I'm not a machine. I have cried, had to go outside and get a hold of myself before. But every time I suck it up and go back in. And at the end, when we debrief, I'll let my team know that I was emotionally touched on that because I don't want them to feel like they have to be, you know, the tough guy. There are no tough guys. That's all made up stuff. This was 2 weeks ago that Lori and I worked on this. This house was so big and so nice, I doubt if I could pay their light bill. But money doesn't buy happiness. This was the man shot his wife in this office and then took his own life. Those are two debris fields in the same office right there. And this went into BioRisk Level 3 because we had to pull up some of that flooring material and the biological materials that actually got into the adhesive that we had to remove. BioRisk Level 4, this is the introduction of a known infectious agent. This is a C. diff job, okay? So there's the top right up there. You can see all that fecal matter. That's highly contagious. It's highly infectious. And at the bottom, you can see it right there after remediation work. But that took a specialized neutralization agent. It took a high-level disinfectant to work on C. diff right there. Okay, so let's go back to it. These are our microbial threats. Enveloped viruses, bacteria, fungi, non-enveloped viruses, mycobacterium, bacterial spores. These are getting stronger all the time. Okay, the days of spray and go, because there's another one coming, folks. It's coming. And we're not going to be able to get away with the nonsense that happened last time. BioRisk Level 5 incident sites involve high consequence bioterrorism, active shooter, mass casualties, and or fentanyl, opioids, and biological WMDs. So we have our threat levels are natural, man-made, biological, and chemical. A common chemical contaminant is tear gas. These are people right here going through the first high-risk, high-level decontamination specialist training program that we did that was specifically designed for fentanyl, heroin, opioids, and biological WMDs. David Hart, you resemble that guy. Yeah, thank you. So is this Mustang? Okay, so here's the deal. I'm fixing to do something, and I swore, and I've grown up, and you know, I've had networks call and say, hey, can we go out with you on a crime scene cleaning job? I'm like, absolutely not. Not for $1 million. I'm not going to intrude on another person's grief for your ratings. That ain't going to happen. I got a call from a major insurance carrier, and they said, this is what we're dealing with. It was an unattended death in a really nice home. And they had called the family head, because you remember when you used to do Yellow Pages years ago? Well, what happens if you Google something now? People that spend the most money go to the top, okay? I'll tell you who it was. It was Aftermath, okay? I have no love for them. So they went out and they cut out a 3/6 by 8 piece of carpet and pad and 3 inches by 18 inches of sheetrock. How long would that take you? Hour and a half, 2 hours. Okay. All right. Let's just say somebody was moving slow that day, 3 hours. No, what if it was 4? Okay. Everything went wrong, you know, that you can think of. They handed them a bill for $26,500. I'm like, holy crap. I mean, I'm a capitalist, but that's obscene. And so then the next people, they got thrown out. So the next people up was one of the big restoration companies, starts with an S, and I'll leave it at that. They came out and they told the family, we can't go in. We didn't bring any PPE. And I said, were they aware this was a loss of life incident site? They said, Jeff, we told them everything that we told you. And I said, okay, what'd they do? They said, they went and looked in all the windows. I said, uh-huh. And I said, and what was their plan? They said, everything's got to go. We got to take everything out. We got to rip all the sheetrock out. The cabinets have to come out. And I went, why? They said, because of odors. Okay. First of all, let me say something to you. There's nothing in an odor that will harm you. It can be obnoxious, but the World Health Organization has already proven this. There's nothing in an odor. Now, the source of it might, but there's nothing in an odor. And I said, you know, folks, I'm not trying to be disrespectful, but when somebody dies in a hospital, they don't tear out the wing. I said, what this needs is forensic restoration, professional forensic cleaning and disinfecting. They're like, you can get rid of it. I said, absolutely. Absolutely. So we drew up a proposal and we submitted it to them. They submitted it to the carriers. Everybody came to agreement and they called me. They said, we want you to do this. And I said, oh, okay. I said, hey, listen, I've been thinking I'm going to violate something that I've asked. I said, you know what you've been through with these other companies? This happens all the time, every day, and nobody even knows about it. If you would allow me to film this, I said, but only for professional circles. I said, I won't use your name or your address or anything, but if you would allow me to film this, maybe we can raise the bar in the industry and maybe save some other families. And they said, okay, we'll let you do that. And I went, really? I said, I will not violate your trust. They said, we know that. They said, Jeff, we talked about you and Lori last night, and our family firmly believes that God brought you into our life. And I was, wow, that is the nicest thing anyone ever said. So what does it start to look like when all these elements come together? Oh, okay. It's childproof.
Well, we've taken a biological hostile environment and we've turned this into a very clean, hygienic environment. We've used the BioSheen system of modern forensic restoration. And we've had scores into the hundreds and hundreds and brought those down, not only just into single digits, but zeros throughout. So this is clean room clean.
Take that, huh?
That's what we want.
What this is, it's a loss of life incident. Loss of life in the world of forensics are 4 types of death: homicide, suicide, accidental, and natural. This was a natural death. Human decomposition begins at approximately 4 minutes after death. He was here for approximately 2 weeks. Variables on this is we have cross-contamination from first responders. Transfer from tracking happens for a minimum of 20 feet from the side of the body. Then we've got cross-bio contamination from vectors, those are flies, and there was a dog here. Okay, dogs have to eat. And we'll visibly see where the dog's diet changed. Well, what we're gonna do is we're gonna start this pathogenic knockdown with an EPA-registered hospital-grade tuberculocidal disinfectant, proven to kill both gram-negative, gram-positive bacteria and inactivate both enveloped and non-enveloped viruses, but it also has a surfactant in it, which will cause that to adhere itself
to surfaces, both vertical and horizontal, and lessen that chance of something going airborne. So when that is loaded and this is loaded and we have the base, that's it for today. Tomorrow we'll get into the rest of it, pulling carpets and everything, and then we'll get into cleaning and disinfecting. Sunday is simply a day for forensic cleaning, disinfecting, showing different delivery systems how and why we do things in a professional manner. Helps when you have a team of professionals. I mean, these people got this house cleared out in about 3 hours. Now it's just, you know, some detail work of removing tack strip and everything, and then tomorrow we'll come in and start our actual cleaning process. The tasks that we want to accomplish this morning are the final removal of the tackle strip, and the sweeping and dusting of the subfloors right through there to prepare them for wet washing, which we'll be doing at over 220 degrees utilizing a mobile cleaning plant. We'll wash that and then dry it, and then we'll have nice surfaces, and we're not tracking and transferring soils from one area to the other or any type of pathogens. When you reach 200 degrees, you've just increased your cleaning proficiency and efficiency by 3,000%. Then we've got these rooms free to dry clean all of our structural surfaces, and their dry cleaning prepares us for wet cleaning.
It's interesting to work with a professional that, you know, like Jeff Jones, that's so detailed, and the way that he goes about his business, very detail oriented, which is the way you need to be.
This is absolutely a clean house right now. But now what we've done is prepared all surfaces for professional disinfecting. Remember, there's pre-disinfecting, there's forensic cleaning, which is the dry cleaning, and then wet cleaning to prepare surfaces for professional disinfecting. Professional disinfecting is the application of an EPA registered hospital grade tuberculocidal disinfectant with a 6-long kill, proven to kill both gram-negative, gram-positive bacteria, all known pathogens, and inactivate. Notice I said inactivate, not kill. You cannot kill a virus. It's not a living organism. It's a zombie. Feel comfortable walking off of this scenario that anyone could come in here. And I've said this before, I absolutely will not pull off an incident side until I'm comfortable that you could open a daycare center. There's not a pathogen on this planet that we can't negotiate.
Here's the deal on that. When we were shooting that, We made an agreement. There were not going to be any do-overs. There was not going to be anything rehearsed. It was just going to be a real world. I said, if I drop the ball and say something stupid, you know, just put it in there because I'm stupid half the time. Okay, but if you ask me a question, I'll just answer it, but we're not going to do anything rehearsed. So I had no idea. And all he did was he stayed out of our way and let us work. And so you saw like basically almost a 3-day project condensed down into something that I could show you and not put you to sleep on. But that's what a project looks like that's on an unattended death job. And so I had some other things that I wanted to do, but I need to do this bit of housekeeping really quick. Larry, would you come up here for a second? Yeah, the guy that looks like you. I've been doing this for a long time, and there are certain people in this industry, you know, that have made a major impact on this. Come here. Come here. Come here.
It's scary now.
Yeah,
man.
Yeah, yeah. You know.
But you have a microphone and I don't.
So. You don't need to say anything. Okay. Yeah, just face me. Okay. Among the Plains Tribes Indians, that when you wanted to honor someone, okay, someone that was a leader, someone that was in line for a chieftain, somebody that was a real warrior that helped the people and helped make the world a better place, you would do that with a Pendleton blanket, okay? But that blanket is just a symbol, okay? It's a symbol of love and admiration and respect, okay? And my sister Rose, she wants to give you a traditional Navajo blessing right now.
This is a kompala. I think we're done.
Okay. Get off my stage.
Thank you.
No.
I'm so sorry. Love you, man.
I hear people talk about, you know, oh, I've had a bad day. Oh, the car was not running right. Oh, I'm getting into it with my spouse, got into it with my boss. Oh, I watched too much CNN or Fox News, okay? That's not a bad day. Let me tell you what a bad day is, okay? I'm going to say the most powerful words in the world to you. Ayo aninishne. And what I just said in Navajo is, I love you. When the day comes that you can no longer say that to someone you care about, or you know that in this life you'll never hear that from them again, then that, my friend, is a bad day. So we've talked about microbes and viruses and germs and fentanyl contaminations and training tactics, techniques, and tools, okay? And went over a lot of stuff really fast. But I'm going to tell you right now, you leave this room, if you only remember one thing that I said today, I want you to remember this. Always be humble and kind.
There's a light that glows by the front door. Don't forget the keys under the mat. When childhood stars shine, always stay humble and kind. Go to church 'cause your mama says to. Visit grandpa every chance that you can. Won't be wasted time. Always stay humble and kind. Hold the door, say please, say thank you. Don't steal, don't cheat, don't lie. I know you got mountains to climb, but always stay humble and kind. When the dreams are to you, when the work you put in is realized, let yourself feel the pride, but always stay humble and kind. Don't expect a free ride from no one. Don't hold a grudge or a chip, and here's why. Stay humble and kind. Know the difference between sleeping with someone and sleeping with someone you love. I love you, ain't no pickup line, so always stay humble and kind. Hold the door, say please, say thank you. Don't steal, don't
Then it's hot, eat a root beer popsicle. Shut off the AC and roll the windows down. Let that summer sunshine always stay humble and kind. Don't take for granted the love this life gives you. When you get where you're going, don't forget, turn back around. Help the next one in line always stay humble and kind.